This is Radhakrishna, lecturer in Computer Science, Chambers Degree College, Palakkad. In the previous session, we discussed about different concepts of analysis model, analysis principles, rules in designing analysis model, use cases, quality function deployment. Like that, we discussed several topics related to requirements and analysis model. Today, I am going to explain about software design basics. Before discussing the software design basics, first let us discuss an important topic, an important term, that is SRS, Software Requirement Specification. What is Software Requirement Specification? After gathering the requirements from the user, the development company will gather all the requirements from the user. The software analyst will take an important role in gathering all the requirements. After gathering requirements from the user, all these requirements will be verified, purified, and validated for their correctness. After completion of this verification, validation, and purification, these requirements will be documented. These finalized requirements will be documented on a document that is called as SRS, Software Requirement Specification. As per the details in this SRS, the developer will go forward. He will try to develop all the given details in the SRS. So, this is the basis to start the software development, and they will follow as per the requirements in SRS document. Here, this SRS document will give us clear details about the entire system, what is to be done. This SRS document contains finalized requirements, what is to be developed. But to go forward for coding and implementation stages, the developer needs these details in another form. So, that these details which are included in this SRS must be converted to different stages, different design models. For implementation and coding, the system must be viewed as architectural design, high level design model, or detailed design model. So, the system must be viewed, the identified details from SRS must be converted to this model. This will give a support, a clarity to the developer what to code, what to implement. So, let us discuss which design will give which type of view. The first one is architectural design. In this architectural design, the architectural design is the highest abstraction version of the system. In this, it identifies the software system with many components. Actually, the software system, the entire system will be viewed as a single item, but it consists of number of items. So, in this architectural system, the system, entire system will be viewed as a single which consists of number of components. That is architectural design. In the design, you can view the system like that. And the second one is high level design. What is this high level design? In this high level design, actually in the previous model, we can conclude about the previous model as it breaks single entity multiple component concept. That is architectural design. Single entity, that means the system will be viewed as a single one and it consists of multiple components. So, about architectural design, simply you can say single entity and multiple component model. That will be converted into less abstraction view of subsystems and models. That means it will be again divided into number of modules in this high level design. In this design, the single entity system will be divided into number of modules. That is the second one. And the third one is detailed design. What the detailed design will give us? Detailed design deal with implementation part. What is seen as a system and its subsystems. In the previous systems, how the system is viewed? In the previous two models, the system is viewed as a single system and subsystems. And in this detailed design, it is more detailed towards modules and their implementations. In this, actually in architectural design, the system is viewed as a single component. And in high level design, the system is viewed as number of modules. And in detailed design, again it will be evaporated. Again, it will be explained in depth as number of components. So the detailed design, it is more detailed towards modules and their implementations. It defines logical structure of each module. This detailed design will give us logical structure of every module. So like that, this can be viewed as a single, and this can be again subdivided model. Again, this is more detailed model. Like that, the design model must be viewed as number of models. Now let us discuss another concept, that is modularization. What is modularization? A module is nothing but this is a part of a main system. A main system can be divided into number of parts. That is called as modularization. Each part can be called as a module. What is the use of module? What is a module that we discuss now? Another concept that I am going to explain, that is modularization. In this modularization, every main system will be divided into some parts. Each part in this will be called as a module. What is the use of module? Why we should divide a system into number of modules? Already, I think all of you will learn about a term, divide and conquer. If you divide a problem into number of parts, then it's very easy to understand each small part. If a problem is viewed as a single one, it will be a little bit complex to solve the problem. But if the same problem is divided into number of parts, then it's very easy to handle that each subpart. So here, this subpart will be called as a module. If you divide a system into number of parts, then that is called as modularization. What is the use of modularization? We will see one by one. First one, advantage of modularization. First one is, smaller components can be easily maintained. It is very easy to maintain. It's very easy to handle smaller components. Suppose if you see construction of a building, if we view the entire building construction process as a single unit, as a single task, it will be very difficult to handle and manage that. But if you divide that entire construction as small parts, entire construction process can be divided into small parts. For example, cement work, iron work, painting work, woodwork, foundation work, electrical work. Like that, if you divide an entire task as separate parts, then it's very handy to maintain each task very easily. That is the first one. Next one, in this modularization, in software point of view, if you divide the system into number of modules, we have another advantage. Program can be divided on its functional aspects. Based on the functions we have, of course, a program can perform one function, another program will perform another function. So, programs can be divided based on their functions. So, one program will handle one function, another one will handle another function. Like that, we can divide all the programs based on their functions. Here, the abstraction can also be maintained. Here, abstraction means we need not specify all the details, we need not express all the inner details. We have to specify only important details only. That is abstraction, which is possible. And here, another facility is there with the help of this modularization. Here, coherence is also possible. That is another advantage. What is cohesion? That cohesion concept we will discuss in next topic. This will help the developer to reuse created programs again and again. So, the topic cohesion will be discussed in our next topic. Similarly, if we design the entire system as modules, we can provide required range of security also for our programs, for our data, and for this system. We can provide required range of security also. That is the advantage of modularization. So, finally, modularization means simply dividing the entire system as subsystem. The advantages, the main advantage in this modularization is it's very easy to manage the project. It will give us to arrange much more security. We can divide all the programs as based on functions. Like that, we have so many advantages of modularization. And another term we have to discuss, that is concurrency, concurrent, concurrency. What is concurrency? Concurrency means performing more than one task at a time. It is possible. Actually, if you see a program, all the statements given in the program will be executed one after another. That is sequential execution. But what is concurrent execution? If more than one is going on at the same time, then it's called as concurrency. So this is very, very important concept. In our project that we're going to develop, we must able to maintain this concurrent transactions also. In some cases, we have to execute more than one programs or more than one transactions at a time. So this is possible and it must be handled in our projects also. Best example for concurrency is in our today's word processor. If you see word processor like Microsoft Word, in this, Microsoft Word will be executed on your screen. It's going on. It's an execution state. At the same time, in background, another task is also going on. That is spell check. Suppose if you type anything, and if you type anything wrong, and if you press a space bar, automatically that word will be highlighted with a red color underline, which shows that sentence or word contains a spelling mistake. That means an internal mechanism is going on continuously running in background. The spell check mechanism is running in background. So on the screen you are viewing Microsoft Word is executing. At the same time, another application is also executing. Another application is also going on in background. That another application is spell check. So these two tasks are continuously, simultaneously executing. So this is called as concurrency. That means executing two tasks, executing two items at the same time is called as concurrency. Here word processor is executing. At the same time, in background, spell check mechanism also executing. So this is the best example for concurrency, and this must be handled in our programs also, in our project also. When a system is divided into small parts, these small parts will be called as modules, and this is called as modularization. In this modularization, there will be some interdependability. So the degree of interdependability between these modules or inside these modules must be measured. This can be measured with the help of two terms, that is cohesion and coupling. Now let us discuss about cohesion. What is cohesion? Cohesion is to calculate or is to measure the interdependability within the module, within the elements of the module. So using cohesion, we can identify the dependability, the degree of interdependability in a module. A module may consist of number of elements. So between these elements, what is the degree of interdependability? It can be measured with the help of cohesion. We have different types of cohesions. Those are, first one is coincidental cohesion. First one is coincidental cohesion, and next one is logical cohesion, and next one is temporal cohesion. Coincidental, logical, temporal, and another one is procedural cohesion, and next one is communication cohesion and sequential cohesion. And sixth one is sequential cohesion, and last one is functional cohesion. These are the types of cohesions. Please study this. First one is coincidental cohesion, next one is logical cohesion, next one is temporal cohesion, and next one is procedural cohesion, and another one is communication cohesion, sequential cohesion, functional cohesion. These are the types of cohesion. Let us discuss each one. What is coincidental cohesion? This coincidental cohesion is an unplanned and random cohesion. This will give us improper results because it is unplanned and random cohesion, which might be the result of breaking the program into smaller elements. So because it is unplanned, it is unreliable. We cannot depend on this. So this can be used very less. Due to its unplanning, it's having some drawbacks also. That's why we never use this coincidental cohesion. And that is the first one we discussed. And next one is logical cohesion. What is logical cohesion? When logically characterized elements are get together, when logically categorized elements, then logically categorized elements are put together, then in a module, then it's called as logical cohesion. If logically categorized elements are put together, we group some elements as a group, we group some elements as a unit, these are logically categorized as a single item. That means some items are having same type of logical characteristics. If we group all these as a module, then that is called as logical cohesion. And the next one is temporal cohesion. In this temporal cohesion, when elements of a module, then if there are some elements on the module, these modules are organized. How these are modules are organized? They are processed at similar time. Modules of elements of a module are processed at a single time. And a module contains number of elements. These elements can be processed at the same time in such that way that module is created. Then it is called as temporal cohesion. How we can define it? Simply, if elements of a module are organized such that they can be processed at the same time, then you can call it as temporal cohesion. That is third one. Next one is sequential procedural cohesion. A procedure means set of instructions, group of instructions. Naturally, these instructions will be executed one by one after another one. Similarly, all elements of a module are grouped together. All the elements of a module are grouped together and they are executed sequentially in order to perform a task. Then that is called as procedural cohesion. All the elements of a module are grouped together. That means some elements are grouped as a module. At the same time, these elements will be executed one after another to perform a task, to complete a task. These will be executed in sequential manner. Then that cohesion is called as procedural cohesion. And the next one is communication cohesion. What is communication cohesion? In this, all the elements will be executed sequentially and all these work on a single data item. Then it is called as communication cohesion. Elements of a module will be executed sequentially, but there will be a common data item, and that common data item, all the elements of the module will be executed. That is called as communication cohesion. And the next one is sequential cohesion. In this, elements of a module are grouped together and the output of one element will be taken as input for another element. That means if you have two elements, E1 and E2, the output of E1 will be taken as input for E2, and with that input E2 will execute. Like that, sequentially, the output of one element will be given to another element as input. That is called as sequential cohesion. And the last one is functional cohesion. In this functional cohesion, this is the highly expected model. In this, all the elements are put together and all the elements will work for all the work. All the elements will work to contribute for a particular function. To work, all the elements of this cohesion will work for a particular function. Then it is called as functional cohesion. So these are different types of cohesions. Once again, I want to repeat: coincidental cohesion, logical cohesion, temporal cohesion, procedural cohesion, communication cohesion, sequential cohesion, and functional cohesion. These are different types of cohesions we have. And next, one more topic that we have to discuss. That is coupling. What is coupling? In cohesion, we discussed the interdependency between elements of a module. Now, another concept that we are going to start. Coupling. This is the interdependency between modules. To find out the degree of interdependency between modules can be identified with the help of this coupling technique. Again, this coupling is also available in different models and different methods. So let us discuss each one. In this coupling, the first one is content coupling. And the second one is common coupling. And third one is control coupling. Like that, we have so many methods. And one is stamp coupling. The fourth one is stamp coupling, and last one is data coupling. Let us discuss each type of coupling. First one is content coupling. Content coupling. What is content coupling? You may have so many modules in a system. In this, if one module can directly refer, change or access data of another module, then you can call it as content coupling. I am repeating the same definition again. Please listen carefully. You may have so many modules in a system. If when a module can directly access, that means using, can directly access or modify or refer the content of another module, then you can call it as content coupling. So one module can directly access, it can directly change, or it can directly use the content of another module. If this is the case, we have to call it as content coupling. And the second one is common coupling. What is this common coupling? If two modules, suppose you may have so many modules, when multiple modules, more than one module, have read and write access on the same common data, on a global data, then it is called as common coupling. That means we may have so many modules. You have three modules. These three modules will have access, that means read and write access on a common global data. These three will use the common global data. These three can read this data. These three modules can read this data. These three modules can write on the data. Then you have to call this as common coupling. The second one, common coupling. Please observe carefully this diagram. And the next one is control coupling. What is control coupling? If one module can control the function the execution of another module, then we have to call it as control coupling. That is third one. Please observe carefully. Now we discuss the content coupling and common coupling. In content coupling, what we discuss, the data of one module can be directly accessed by another module. That is, in common module, common data, global data will be used by number of modules. And what about next one, control coupling? One module can control the function or flow of execution of another module, then it's called as control coupling. So please study. I'll have two modules, M1, M2, M3, and M4. Just imagine. Here, what I'm saying is, if one of the available modules decides the flow of execution, the function of another module, for example, if M1 can decide the execution of M2, if M1 can control the execution of M2, if it decides, then we have to call it as control coupling, third one. Please study. Similarly, if M3 can decide the execution of M4, then it's also called as control coupling. That is third one. And next one is fourth one, stamp coupling. What is stamp coupling? If multiple modules are using same data item, say data D, M1, M2, M3, these three are using same data item, but of different parts of the data item. That means M1 is using this part, M2 is using this part, and M3 is using this part. These three are using same data item, but of different parts. There will be different parts of a data. A data item may have different parts. For example, if you imagine a table or a file, that file may have different parts. So, all the modules are sharing using same data, but each module is using different parts of the data. If that is the case, then we have to call it as stamp coupling. Finally, data coupling. What is data coupling? In this data coupling, when two modules interact with each other, two modules will be interacted with each other by passing data as parameters, and with the passed data, the destination module will work. For example, I have M1 and M2. This M1 will interact with M2 by passing data as parameter, and this data will be passed to M2, and with the text, this M2 will work. Like that, there the interaction will be performed. There they will interact like that. One module can interact with another module by passing data as parameters, and with the passed data, the destination module will work. This is called as data coupling. Like that, we have different types of couplings. Those are content coupling, common coupling, control coupling, stamp coupling, and data coupling. These are types of coupling. After this, in this session, finally, we have to discuss one more topic. That is, design verification. That is the last concept in this session. Design verification. What is design verification? Up to now, in our discussions, what we concluded in the previous stages, we have to gather requirements, we have to analyze them, we have to create different data models, we have to solve different problems, and finally, we have to finalize a design. This is up to now discussion. So, the output of software design process is, what is the output in the previous stages? Up to now, we discussed about software design process. In this design process, what is the output we gathered? Several documentation, different diagrams, data flow diagrams, pseudo codes, structured English, detailed logical diagrams, functional requirements, non-functional requirements, context diagrams. Like that, we identified so many designs, so many models, and we got some output as a result of the previous stages work. This is the finalized design. So, after completion of the design, the next phase is implementation. With the help of this design, with the help of this identified design, with the help of the output of the previous stages, we have to move forward to the next stages. The next stage is implementation. We have to implement the project with the help of this design. But before going to implementation, we must verify the design. Of course, we created the design very carefully. We have taken all the precautions. With the help of those precautions and those rules, we designed a very good model, of course. But we should verify before going to the next stage. We should verify the identified, planned, finalized design before going to the next stage. So, it is necessary, it is compulsory to verify the output before proceeding to the next phase. Because if in the early stages, if you identify any error, it can be rectified. Suppose if you overlook, if you left any error in this design, and with by basing on the design, if you are going to next phases, if you identify any error in the forward phases, then it's not possible to move back. Again, if you come back to rectify these errors, again it will waste your time and different resources. So, after completion of the designing, again this must be verified for errors, for mistakes. If we left any requirement, we must verify. Whether you left any requirement, whether you did any mistake, either any error we left, all these must be verified. Some verification must be performed on the identified design. After verifying, when it is decided that no error is there in the design, then only we must go forward. Then it will give a good product, software product. So, before going to the next stage, implementation, it must be verified. Here, we can use a method to verify. That is, by structured verification. By structured verification approach, reviewers can detect those who can verify the design. Those can be called as reviewer. So, with the help of, by using a structured verification approach, reviewer can detect the defects that might be caused, that is due to overlooking. These can be detected and these can be rectified. A good design review is very, very important because it can identify the defects, then these can be rectified, then we will get an accurate, a perfect, high performance, high quality software product. So, after completion of design, the design must be verified for errors and any important problems. All these must be verified in the finalized design. After verifying the design, when you decide that no error is there in the design and the design is very good, if you decide everything, if you decide that the design is very good, no errors are there in the design, then only you can go for next phase, that is called as implementation. So these are the concepts of design verification.